The next section we're going to talk about, we talked about the safety, the aspects of the distributor, understanding the knowledge of the materials, because it can be hot. We want to make sure safety is our number one priority, right? Agencies around the country, that's our number one priority. That definitely has to happen. But next, what else needs to happen? We need to be knowledgeable about the material itself. The distributor driver, the designers that are designing the roads, and et cetera, need to have awareness of what all the material is, and that's what we're going to cover this next section. Along with, we're going to talk a little bit about your specifications and et cetera, where those specifications came from, how states go about using their specifications, and then we're going to go into some of the different aspects. Because currently, right now, there is no specifications of asphalt for tack coats. However, I'm working with a group to establish one, so hopefully that'll get out here in the near future. But with that said, here's kind of a simple schematic diagram of tack coats, our three primary tack coats that we use out in the field. Our material comes from the crude, from the ground. It's been taken up into our refineries. Then from the refineries, it's taken into a truck and to the plants. When it comes to the plants, we got our materials that are on top of the tanks, which is our light ends. That's your gas, diesels, kerosenes, and et cetera. Then you have the materials on the bottom of the tanks. That's your asphalt cements. That's your base products of where our three tack coats come from. They're our primary. The first one that we'll talk about is the cutbacks. And as you can see, the cutbacks are blended with these light ends, the gas, diesels, and lubricating oils. And it also includes that asphalt cement as the base product. Next is your asphalt cements. Your PG64, 22s is often most common, and et cetera. And lastly is your emulsions. With your emulsions, you have the water, you have an emulsifying agent with the soap, and then it's broken down by cationic, anionic, and we'll talk about that further as we go. Asphalt cements. One of the products that we use for tack, as you can see, temperatures between 300 and 350 degrees. Often the case, you know, we're out there, we're paving the jobs, why can't we use the asphalts that we're using for our HMA for our tack? And that's been kind of an instance where a lot of DOT says, well, let's try it. And Georgia has been one, like Dave mentioned, that has been using it over many, many years. It comes in multiple grades. As we said, 6420 is the most common. However, safety is a big issue. Understanding the materials can be very hot at those type of temperatures. And if you're doing this at nighttime construction, there's an opportunity where people could get hurt, burned, and et cetera. However, as Dave mentioned, what don't we have to not have to worry about? We don't have to worry about breaks, so yahoo! However, you know, we are going to track, that material can track. So there's some issues still with that. In Georgia, they've had issues with tracking, and sometimes the contractor has to have a separate person come out there and take that tracking off the tires to take care of that issue. So it doesn't alleviate all the tracking, but that can be an issue. Furthermore, cutbacks. It has the AC-based product along with the petroleum distillates, and the temperatures between 70 to 210, much more manageable. And it's broken down further down the bottom, slow curing, medium curing, rapid curing, how fast it evaporates. For those states that are in the winter time, what's the difference between a cutback and emulsion in the winter time? Sorry? Freezing? Exactly. Emulsions freeze in the winter time. That's why a lot of maintenance type of work activities in the winter time, a lot of times cutbacks are used. However, cutbacks, because of air quality standards and things like that, we've kind of gone away from and kind of go back to some of our emulsions that are often used. Furthermore, emulsions. Here again, you have your AC base product, your water and soap, and it's in a mill, collateral mill, how it's produced. But let's first think about what we talked about, Dave said about water and oil or emulsions. They don't mix very well. So those that have had children, their bicycle chain comes off, mommy and daddy come and help me. What happens? Mommy and daddy gets their hands greasy. We come into the house, we have to clean our hands. What do? When we mix just water with the grease, what happens? It smudges It gets, you know, it doesn't come off. What happens when we add soap, though? The soap molecules go along with the emulsion particles. They come together, and you're able to mix them very well, and your hands will become clear. That's the kind of same process that occurs with using this water and soap mixture. That soap's be able to bind with those outside molecules, and you're able to mix it really well. Keep that in mind. Here again, the temperature is 130, 160, much more manageable. And lastly, they're broken up by anionic and cationic. So what's the difference between anionic and cationic? Well, anionic is basically negative charge. It's that negative charge surrounding that asphalt molecule. Cationic being the positive charge around that asphalt molecule. So who can tell me what's the most common type of anionic or cationic used in Utah? Anionic or cationic? Cationic, exactly. And why do we use cationic? Because that material will then react better with our base product, our aggregate, and bind really well, and that's the purpose of why we use cationic. Furthermore, we talked about cationic and anionic. Which is negative? Anionic, that's correct. It's broken down by rapid set, medium set, and slow set. And again, this is how fast it will evaporate. How fast you can get the equipment onto the road, the traffic, and et cetera, et cetera. Let's talk a little bit of rapid set. What can a rapid set material do? Well, rapid set material doesn't have the opportunity to bind with that coarse and fine material because it sits onto the ground, it evaporates, and you're ready to put traffic on. Medium setting, it has that ability to bind with that coarse material, but not as much as the fine material. And then you have the slow set, which is able to bind with the coarse and the fine material, which that's why a lot of states around the country use slow sets. Furthermore, when it comes to rapid settings, a lot of states out east, Connecticut, New York, all the states that do nighttime construction, they don't have much windows of opportunity to put our pavements down. That's why they go with a rapid set. However, the storage capability, as Dave mentioned, becomes an issue because you're given very short windows when that material can be stored, and that could be a problem. Furthermore, on the positive, and which one do we say that one was? That's the cationic, and that's why the C's are in the front of the abbreviations. Here with this slide, it kind of shows the molecules as the water disperses those molecules. And then as it evaporates, those molecules come together. You have the brown color with the bubbles on top of the roadway surface. Then after time, that brown goes away, so does the bubbles, and it turns into a black. It creates that pH change and et cetera, and then curing and evaporation leads to coalescence. So with a little bit of that background, now let's talk a little bit about the nomenclature. What does it mean about QS and HF and et cetera? Well, QS stands for quick sets, and often in the case, that's used for your microsurfacing and things like that. And for you guys use it for a tack, which will set up quicker. Then you have your high floats, which contain a lot of petroleum distillates that some DOTs have still used, and there's very few. Now when you have your slow sets and your cationic slow sets, you'll have a dash and you'll have a number following that. What does that number mean? Often the case, you'll have a 1 or possibly a 2. And that 1 or 2 will basically break down if it's a binder residue, if its viscosity is high or viscosity is low. Furthermore, often the case, as we mentioned, it's nice to see Utah using this, you'll have a 1 and you'll have an H. And what does that H stand for? And it's shown and it's said right in your specification, it represents the harder based asphalts. And to give you guys a little background, what does it mean by harder and soft asphalts? How many of you have worked in a laboratory and you did a penetration test? There are a few of you out there. Well, this simple test is one of the performance tests that you do, which you take your emulsions and you put it in a little tin can like this. Then you put it, you submerge it in the water, and you take a little needle, and it penetrates the material. For those that are harder material, what's going to happen, do you think, to that needle? it's not going to go down as far, right? If you have a softer material, it's going to penetrate a lot more. So this common test has been around for years. It's just one of the physical tests that's done for your emulsions. And unfortunately, it's not like a PG-graded binder, which has rotational viscosity and some of the other things that can be done. This is one of the few tests, that's, and I will pass it around. One is a trackless tack material, so it shows you kind of how hard it is. And the other one's kind of a slow set material. In addition, in some parts of the country, Ohio and et cetera, you have companies that are your tire builders, your Goodyear, and Brewage, and so forth. They often like to see their product be used on the roadways itself. So in Ohio, they've came to the DOT and wanted to use some latex modifiers and et cetera. So they've incorporated that as a possible candidate that they use for the tack coats, and they label those as L&P and et cetera. Now we'll go into the specifications itself, and where do they come from? Well, they came from basically the AASHTO and the ASTM procedures M140 and D977. Here for the anionic, it's broken down by the penetrations between 100 to 200 and penetrations from 40 to 90. So what did we say with the penetrations that are low? Those are the harder base asphalts. And as you can see here, here's some of the categories that fit in that mold. And then for the higher penetration values, there are some in that. That's for anionic. And then here's for cationic, the breakdown, et cetera, for the penetrations that are low and et cetera. Everybody see that point? Because that's kind of the basics of where we're going to go from here and on. Also, for the cutbacks, you have your AASHTO at ASTM procedures, and they're broken up in different grades, from an RC70 to an RC3000 to a medium curing 70 to a medium curing 3000. Now, for the next 5 or 10 minutes, let's talk about your tack coat specifications here in Utah. As you guys know, it's in the section 02748, and I apologize, this is not included in your handouts, because when we make these handouts, we have one particular location that makes them and then sends them out to all the different states. But following this workshop, we'll have this presentation available. You guys will be able to download it and then take this material with you. For this particular specification, it's broken up in prime and tack coat, and I've just taken out some of the material that's related to the tack. The first section that we talk about is the materials and the procedures. And here, I've highlighted some key words that kind of you guys should see as very important as well. For the tack coat, the asphalt emulsion to on the existing surface or a new pavement surface and intermediate lifts. So there's a different opportunities when a tack coat can be used within your state. Some states that we go to, they don't allow it between lifts and et cetera, but for you guys, you have all three of these opportunities. Next, it comes more into the definition of the emulsion. It talks about the asphalt products using water and soap. They represent it as emulsifier. As well, they use that to reduce the viscosity. Furthermore, it's broken down by the 60% asphalt and 40% emulsifier. So you have that breakdown. We talked earlier that it's commonly often we use 57%, and for you guys use 60. And through the example equation that we'll be doing here in a few minutes, we'll be using 57% residual. Furthermore, it talks about section 02745 for the exact ratio as well as other properties. And they break it out. The product is called a straight or a concentrate emulsion in this condition. We talked about earlier for Utah, often the case, a cationic slow set 1H or a cationic quick set 1H is used, and it's referred to in an article section 2.1 for further reference. And then lastly, it talks about the H standing for hard, so now you have a little bit of background on where that comes from. Furthermore, when it comes to dilution, and Howard said, it's basically up to the distributor are up to the contractor if they want to use it or not, but they often in the case they don't like to allow the dilution, but it is allowed there is an application rate, a small 0.03 gallons per yard square. Furthermore, it talks about the dilution. It can be a 1-to-1 or a 2-to-1. And here, as you see in the darker orange colors, these have been some changes recently from your 2012 specification. It talks about dilution, meaning two parts emulsion to one part water for the later case when it is done. In addition, there is an example equation that can go through as you can follow up and see what your dilution rate's going to be if it's 2-to-1 and etc. Furthermore, it talks about submittals. And normally the case, there's approved products that have to come through the DOT for approval, as well as when it comes time for construction, the REs on the projects normally get what they call a bill of lading. Who's familiar with a bill of lading? All right, we got some hands. So I don't really need to go over this section. Well, for those that haven't seen, this is a typical example of a bill of lading. And within your specification, it talks about all the important pieces of it, but as I'll go through, it also identifies where the source material comes from. In addition, it has a bill of lading number. It talks about where the material was, the date, the customer information, talks about the product, it talks about the load times, the delivery times. It goes in some of the further information about product specification. It provides what that specific gravity is going to be. And keep in mind, we're going to talk about this 60 degrees Fahrenheit number here in a second when it talks about temperature, as well as it goes into some gross weights, net weights, and et cetera. Here you can see what the product is. It's a cation quick set, 1H. It references its 2-to-1 dilution, as well as, you know, further net tons and et cetera. Often the case down below in this section, it talks about referencing that they have followed the standard specifications when it comes to the DOT's process and et cetera. And last but not least, there's a signature on the bottom for approval. That's a quick kind of a review of the bill of lading. Furthermore, on the tack coat, again, it referenced the cationic quick set and the cationic slow set 1H. It talks about for required maintenance of traffic, the MOT, for the ability to for fuel for fully cured before allowing traffic on the roadway. So as we talked about before, did we mention that word cure in some of our definitions? Is that a specific nomenclature that everybody's familiar with? What does it mean by you guys? What does it mean by cure? Does it mean break? Does it mean set? So again, we got to make sure that everybody understands what that word means when it says cure. Furthermore, it breaks down residual asphalt content, approximately 60%. It says dilutions by the terminal only, as well as you do not change the dilution before obtaining written approval by the engineer. And that, as we go through these workshops, that is highly recommended that we do. Furthermore, continuation allows for using PG-graded binders. But who can tell me why, when you use a PG-grade binder for, say, a fabric, why you wouldn't want to use an emulsion? Because you wouldn't get the really proper bond if you use an emulsion. And when you use a PG-graded binder, it's highly recommended. Furthermore, do not use an emulsion or cutback in paving fabric placement, et cetera, just what I was mentioning. We talked about surface preparation. Here it states that it needs to be clean. So often the case for the contractors out there, how do you go about cleaning your surface? Sweepers. That's often the case, it's most common. In some parts of the country that we've gone to, in Connecticut and some of those et cetera ones, they come actually out there and they micromill the top surface and then allow traffic to drive on it for a few days to try to alleviate some of that dust that's on the surface and helps, and then they apply their tack coats. That's kind of a best practice. Also in Illinois, they have kind of like vacuum sweepers that will actually sweep it and also vacuum material right up as well. Just another option. And last but not least, cover all tack surface areas with surface materials the same day of tack coats being applied. In some of the rural areas of mid-America, they will go out and tack for 2 or 3 days ahead of time And what do you think the reason, or what do you think the consequences with that would be? You might get additional materials onto that tack, then you're going to have to sweep that off. It becomes a major issue. So it's recommended, and it's nice to see here within your spec, that says only for that same day is she should be allowing it. Furthermore, on application rates, it has for residual and undiluted, it has the proper applications. In addition, the recent update is provides it for a 1-to-1 dilution and a 2-to-1 dilution. And further information down below. As one of the best practices, most often the case DOTs will just have one application rates for a milled surface, unmilled, PCC, and et cetera. And it's nice to see Utah DOT has kind of came on board and added some differences, because what's going to happen? Are you going to need more emulsion on, say, a milled surface compared to a regular asphalt that's freshly new? Probably not. So that's why the variations in those different amounts. Furthermore, continuation, you need approval for the quantities, the rate of application, the temperatures, and the areas to be treated before an application is applied. As well as, this is one of the comments that was on here, it states, on a wet, do not apply tack coat on a wet surface or where surface conditions prevent proper adhesion. What is our emulsion made out of? Water. So if we have a little bit of moisture on the roadway, is that good? Or what if we have a lot of water that's ponding? Is that good? That question is up to you guys. I'm sorry?
It should be a dry surface.
It should be a dry surface. But states like Puerto Rico or Florida, the amount of rain that they get, they may have a little bit of moisture on their roadway, just a little bit. It's not ponding. So they would work with their RE to get the approval process if they can move forward. So a little moisture is probably not going to hurt. If any case, it probably might help. Furthermore, it talks about surface temperatures below 50 degrees Fahrenheit. Anything below that, it's going to cause some issues when it comes to breaking and setting, as well as when weather conditions prevent proper adhesion. And then lastly, protect all structures, including items such as guardrails and guideposts, from being splattered or marred when the application is being applied. Because no one wants to go back out there and clean up that mess, because we'll have cities and local agencies and et cetera complain that that's a problem. Furthermore, we brought out earlier on, we talked about uniform application. It's mentioned in your specification that using a pressure distributor to apply asphalt, a uniform continuous spread, keep the viscosity between 50 and 100, apply the tack coat between all lifts, as mentioned again, and allow the tack coat to fairly cure before allowing traffic on the paving. Lastly, there's a section on traffic control. Yes, sir. But when we talk about base, what type of material do we call that?
Prime.
We call that our prime. And often the case on our prime, our application rates are just a little bit more than our tack coat application. And then again, and in addition, when we talk about prime coats, often the case, the material that's often used is kind of a cutback material, because it penetrates really well and evaporates and so forth. So, and there's difference of opinion, and we'll get into that a little bit later. Some folks say use a prime, some say no. There's different opinion. Not everybody can agree to the same matter. Answer your question, sir? Furthermore, it talks about the traffic control, referred to section 01554. It says maintain the tack code until the next course is being placed. We definitely want to make sure we put the proper cones in there so people are not swerving in and out of that when the lane's closed and when that tack coat's being applied. Furthermore, in measurement of pavement, here in Utah, it's measured by the ton, but as mentioned by Dave in our discussions yesterday, some projects are using incidental, some projects actually use an amount for a pay for a tack coat, so we often like to recommend it be used as a pay item in a contract. Furthermore, sampling of the materials. Often the case, samples are taken out in the field. However, we need to properly identify where those samples come from, what type of materials being used, and et cetera. And here we got from Pennsylvania that went really in depth about all the material, all the things that needed for that particular material. It talked about, you know, material name. For this one, it was a CRS-1P emulsion. It talked about the quantity. It talked about where the sample was taken, the source, and project name, lot number, sampled by, and et cetera. All plays a major role. In addition, how are samples of emulsion usually taken out in the field? They're in a plastic can or a metal can. What is the preferred method?
Plastic
can. Should we have it half full or completely full?
Completely full.
Completely full. You guys are on top. And the reason behind that is because some things can happen with that emulsion if it's not completely full. Furthermore, in some states, here was New Mexico, in their construction manual, they had further information for inspectors, what some of the things they need to be looking on the lookout for, application rate, temperatures and weather conditions, preparation of a surface, as well as the application of the asphalt material itself, making sure the certificate of compliance or it's on their approved products list. In addition, as a check spray bar height, overlap of the asphalt materials, and et cetera. All very good common things for our inspectors out in the field to need to know. We kind of briefly went over it. Now what happens when we have new products come on board? What needs to be established? Often the times the contractors that are using this, the industry people, will take this information to the state and try to get some kind of special provision to be allowed within their state to use for that material on their particular projects. For this particular example, we show that Virginia has 6 approved products that they currently have for tack code application and et cetera. Manuals of practice. We have a lot of young people coming on board and even those old timers. Where can they go for further information when it comes to emulsions? Well, here's just a few. The MS4, the MS19, 16, and the MS22. We oftenly like to reference the MS-19. It's a manual like this. If you don't happen to have it, you may want to try to get yourself a copy. It has a lot of good valuable information in there. It's become very useful. So that's manuals. What about practices that DOTs and agencies are using? Are there some best practices out there? Well, one of them is North Carolina DOT. They have a Tack Code Best Practice Field Guide that was developed in 2012, because they had some issues with the contractors and the DOT, and to assist in those efforts, they established this field guide. And within this field guide, it talks about when is a tack coat required, what are the 4 essential requirements for a successful tack coat application. It talks about the different grades that they use within their state. It talks about existing surface preparation, et cetera. So very valuable. If you guys look into Google, just type in North Carolina Tack Code Best Practice Guide, and you guys will see this. As well, some DOTs will have some manuals of practice in their design manuals. And here's one for California for Tack Code guidelines to help the designers to understand better what we talked about today about the nomenclature and et cetera. Next, when Dave started this research, there was about 8 states that were currently doing some kind of research. As we've gone around the country, that number's probably quadrupled and so forth, with DOTs doing more types of experimental research on application rates and type of materials to be used. In addition, and we'll talk about this a little bit, the NCHRP 712 report did some test sections around the country as well, where they actually put the material on a roadway surface itself and applied it and had traffic on it to give us some kind of idea how it's going to perform. And that's in the NCHRP 9-440A, as well as Sharp 2 came along and looked at some of the additional information, NCAD, and etc. Dave talked about the NCHRP 712 being a very comprehensive study when it came to tack coat, and these are just some of the things that they looked at. They looked at numerous test methods, the shear, tension, and torsion, and Dave will talk about that in the next couple modules, as well as they looked at the mini tack materials itself. They looked at application rates. They looked at an international survey, what other countries are using, as well as the one that we felt was the most appropriate for us is the variety of surfaces, both AC and PCC. The differences of application on a new, old, milled, unmilled, dry, wet, clean, and dirty. All are dependent and can be different on application. And last but not least, they looked at 8 test temperatures. The conclusions that came out of that, they recommended shear testing, and Dave will talk about that. They also looked at the stiffer base asphalts are performing better. So those emulsions that you guys are using, the slow set 1H, that H being the harder base, they're saying that's performing better. As well as they looked at milled surfaces when they're applying the tack coat, having a milled surface instead of a non-milled surface will perform better with a tack, and etc. The next we're going to talk about is the quality and the inspection. The distributor itself, it's gone over many years of changes, which used to be a horse and buggy, and then came the guy in the back of the distributor looking at the nozzles, and now it's a very sophisticated device like this, putting a very thin application of tack coat on the roadway itself. This is the way it used to be, empirical judgment. Well, our project, we used this application rate last time. Well, we'll just use it this time. Doesn't take into account of the material that they're using and et cetera, so things are a little different. Everybody agree with this? Oh, no, yeah. All right. I'm just nodding my head up here like a crazy man. And the reason for that, we want to make sure, and it's in your spec, that term uniformity. We want to see this. We don't want to see this. In Alabama, they call that fudge striping. No laughs on that one. Oh, we got one. Yay. Zebra striping, there's other places in the country call it different things, but this is definitely what we don't want to see out on our roadways, on our projects. Furthermore, now we'll go into talking about the residual asphalt binder and the emulsions. For the slow set emulsions, it usually consists of 67% asphalt and 33% water. Generally, we use this ratio to estimate our residual asphalt. And the definition of residual asphalt is that remaining material on the pavement after the water and solvents have evaporated. We're all clear on that? Furthermore, so how does one take, yes, sir?
On the slide before you said it's 67% asphalt, 33%, that's in the original, that's your original material.
Yes.
Before you polluted.
Again, it's typical. Depending on the materials, it could be a little different. And a lot of times in your emulsions, there are so many varieties of the emulsions out there. You got to keep that in mind. And that's where we highly recommend working with the supplier on the materials itself. It's not like a PG graded binder. The emulsions have a lot of characteristics that you really need that supplier to help you along. Moving on, your guys are inspectors, you're contractors on the jobs. You know what your shot rate is. How do I convert that to residual, right? Right? Sound like a great idea, right? Well, if you don't have any dilution, you take that application rate and you divide by 1.5, and that'll give you a residual. This is really quick and easy. You're not going into any of the temperature correction factors or anything like this. This is a simple ballpark to give you a number. If you have dilution, you take that number and you divide by 3, and that'll give you a residual. Furthermore, here's a kind of schematic that shows the same things as I've just mentioned. What are the units for applications of our tack coat? Gallons per square yard. Application rates can vary between 0.04 to 1.0. What is the typical application rate for a tack coat? 0.04? 0.04. What about silk coats? Application rate for those? 0.3, 0.4. What about chip seals? 0.4. And then we talked about fabrics, making sure you use a PG-graded binder, and that application rate is going to be 0.25. So those are the differences that you have out there. Distributors can be used for a lot of variety of things, prime coat, dust control, and et cetera. So Tack Coat is just one of the many ways that they can use that type of vehicle. Whoops. So with that said, we have the driver in the distributor truck and things that he can control. He can incorporate what his application width, he can incorporate what his spray width is going to be, his roadway width of the surface, right? That's simple. He knows what his application rate is, or what he wants to have. However, his speed on how fast he drives that vehicle will dictate the material coming out of that and the pressure of the gallons per minute. As shown on this side, the slower he drives, his gallon per minutes are going to decrease. If he increases his speed, his gallons per minute are going to increase. Keep in mind, also, your nozzles are going to play a major role as well. Next, we're going to talk about temperature and why temperature plays a very important role. And on here it shows for temperatures that are higher than 60 degrees Fahrenheit, you're going to need to spray more emulsion. If the temperatures are less than 60 degrees Fahrenheit, you're going to need to spray less emulsions. And again, there's that common word, uniform applications, very important. That's what we want to strive for. As well as right on the top first bullet, it talks about dilution rates. Understanding dilution rates and what kind of dilution that you have, 1-to-1, 2-to-1, is very critical. And lastly, the DOTs or contractors need to take appropriate samples as the day goes by. This is often the case inside the distributor cab. They're controlling operation. Here you can see what their speed is, 300 feet per minute. There's their pressure, and then the application rate. Here they got some nozzles they can turn off and on. That's how it's done. For those that don't have those type of apparatuses, often the case, this is used. Probably very similar to those that have been in engineering school, kind of like the slide rule. So I got a prize here. Who can tell me, if you go up to a contractor and he says, I have a wet tank, what do you think he means by that? Water in the tank, and it's probably going to be kind of an emulsion type, right? If it's a dry tank, what do you think that's going to be? Yes, that is correct. So keep that in mind. Who said that over here? Thank you, sir. There you go. So for those that don't have the sophisticated devices, they'll often use the slide rule, and here on top is the spray bar, the length. You line those lines up to the application rate, then you have your distributor speed and your pump discharge. You line that all up, and that'll give you the numbers that you need. Next comes the material that's being applied on a square yard. How much tack coat material is often the case used on a square yard? A Pepsi can? A couple liters? What do you guys think? What is 6.4 ounces?
Less than three quarters of a cup.
Not very much, is it? When we developed these little slides, my little daughter was beside me, and she was drinking this little fruitable drink, and at that time I looked at it and it said 6.75 fluid ounces. So not very much at all, is it? Very little. So just kind of another little reference. Moving on, we're next going to go and talk about application calculations. How after now you got all this information, how do you go about calculating your residual asphalt? And inside your folder, you'll have a handout that looks like this that talks about calculating tack coat application rates by volume. Can everybody please take that out? We're going to go through this little exercise and kind of work out so everybody understands how to go about getting their residual application rates. But before we do that, we got a couple things that we want to talk about. We'll go back to that NCHRP report, 7, and it talked about, in that report it surveyed the DOTs and it talked about the allowable dilution sites. And as you can see here, the most common was at the supplier's terminal. Next came in the distributing tank itself, then the contractor storage tank, and then not allowed at all. Furthermore, we talked a little bit about temperature correction factor. We talked about the 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Why do we need to know that? Because asphalt and water expands and contracts when these temperatures deviate from that temperature. As well as temperatures rise above 60 degrees Fahrenheit, expansion occurs. The one document that we often the case and a lot of DOTs use is the temperature correction factor table that's often found in the MS-19 manual. And that table is like this. And for this particular example that we'll go through, we're giving you guys at a temperature of 160 degrees Fahrenheit, we're giving you guys this correction factor 0.9750. So keep that in mind. Next, for calculating field application rates, there are three primary ways you can go about doing this. The first is by volume, in which Utah does. The second is by weight. And lastly, it's by the direct measurement ASTM D2995 method. And often the case, a lot of DOTs have used this method for chip seals and etc. over the years, so this is not very uncommon. Let's go back to that NCHRP 712 report. What is oftenly used? They surveyed the states. Most often is used is the volume, as shown here in the brown. Next was weight, and then etc. Furthermore, for calculating the rates by volume, what are some ways that can be done out in the field? Well, first can be done by looking at the gauge in the back of the truck. However, as those trucks age, what do you think happens to that gauge in the back of the truck? It gets rusty, it gets corroded, it goes bad, so that's often the case. That becomes a factor about estimating your amount becomes an issue. Next becomes a calibrated tank stick that's measured on top of the manhole cover. And often in the case, these calibrated sticks will come with the distributor when they're brand new. And often in the case, those calibrated sticks, there's a little device where that calibrating stick will stick right up above on the top of that tank. And those sticks will be used to measure your measurement before you started the application and then after you did your application, and then you can do your volume correction. Here it talks about measuring the tanks. You need to keep in mind you need some kind of correction factor when the temperature and etc. Here's a schematic diagram showing that calibrated stick. And often the case, you'll have another distributor. What you don't want to do is change sticks because each truck will have a different stick. You need to keep that in mind. Furthermore, you want to make sure that tank is level, because if it's not level, that's going to give you inaccurate readings. Furthermore, for your equation, you need to convert the square feet to square yards, and here's the equation. Moving on, for calculating rates by volume, the tank volume method for determining quantity of the material distributed must be determined by the volume of material corrected at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. So keep that in mind. We want to take that back to 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Let's do this example problem. Some of the things given to you up front, we're going to have a slow set 1H, which will have a minimum ash toll, specified residual asphalt content of 57%. Keep that in mind. And we're going to specify a 60 degrees Fahrenheit of undiluted emulsion rate, which will yield the following in-place residual asphalt content in gallons per square yard. Where we're given to you guys on your table, you have a volume at the start, you have the volume at the end, you have the temperature of the material, you have that correction factor, you have the station numbers, you have the width, and you're told that it's diluted 1:1. So let's take the next 5-10 minutes and calculate what our residual application rate is going to be. So let's work out this problem together. Well, the first thing, our distance traveled. Pretty simple, right? We know it's 5,600 feet minus 3,500 feet, and what are we going to get for an answer? 2,100 feet. All right, step one down. Step two, area sprayed. We take that 2,100, multiply 14, divide by 9, and what are we going to get? 3,267 square yards. Next, step three, the hot gallons being sprayed. We take the 1,875 gallons, we subtract 1,250 gallons, and what are we going to get? 625 gallons at 160 degrees Fahrenheit. So what do you think our next step's going to be? We're going to have to take that temperature back to 60 degrees, right? And we're going to use that correction factor from that chart on the MS-19 manual. Some often the case is right in your guys' specifications, in some DOT specifications. So for 60 degrees Fahrenheit gallons, you take the 625 and you multiply it by 0.975, and you're going to get 609 gallons at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. All right, everybody, so far so good? Next, we're going to look at the 609 diluted gallons. We told it's 1-to-1, so what does that mean? We have dilution, we're going to have to divide by 2. And that's where we're going to get. We're going to get 304.5 undiluted gallons. Next, we're going to have to take that final rate, 304.5, divided by 3,267 square yards, and we're going to get, what are we going to get? 0.0938 gallons per square yards. Are we done yet? Are we done yet? Nope, we're going to have to take and affect that residual, right? And what did we say the typical averages for that residual is going to be? 57%. We're going to multiply that, and we're going to get 0.053 gallons per square yards. That's our residual application rate. Understood?
It's just the typical average, that 0.57.
Yes.
Why
yes.
Do you take the water out twice?
Why did we take the water
out?
Why did we take... Well, we're just taking, because we know it's diluted, 50-50, and that's why we divide by 2. So, again, if you guys have 2-to-1, you're going to have to divide whatever that ratio is going to be out in the field. All right, let's look at the comments on this. The pros and cons, it's quick, it's simple, and the accuracy improves with larger areas. However, the cons, you're going to have to take care of some kind of measurement by looking at the gauge or actually putting a calibrated stick inside the distributor. You're going to have to use a temperature correction factor, and dilution rate is going to be vital. You need to know what that dilution rate is. Next, let's work on the example for weight. For calculate the application of rate is probably the most accurate method. The bill of lading, as we talked about here in Nebraska, It contained a 60 degrees Fahrenheit weight per gallon. The weight measurements are not affected by temperature, so we're not going to have to use a correction factor. In addition, it's recommended method for full load applications, calibrations, and etc. However, often the case, some of our projects are out in the middle of some people refer to as Timbuktu. Are we going to have any kind of scales out there to record those measurements? Probably not, so that's going to be a difficulty. Here's a schematic, basically taking the weight at the beginning, the weight end. For this particular exercise, on the back of the volume, we'll have this. We're going to specify a cationic slow set 1H again with a 57% residual, and we're giving that 57 residual to you. The tear weight of the amping distributor is going to be 26,000 pounds. We know we're going to have a dilution of 1-to-1, so that loaded weight is going to be 54,000 pounds. The density through the bill of lading is going to show 8.350 pounds per gallon. Our application width is going to be 15 feet, and our length is going to be 3 miles. Let's calculate altogether our application rate in pounds per yard squared. The first step, let's determine the pounds of diluted emulsion being applied. So we take that beginning weight, and we subtract our final weight, our ending weight, and what are we going to get? We're going to get 28,000 pounds. Next, we're going to account for dilution, so we're going to divide by 2, just like the first example, and we're going to get 14,000 pounds of cationic slow set 1H. Now we're going to use that 57% factor, we're going to multiply it by 14,000 pounds, and we're going to get 7,980 pounds. Next, we want to calculate the application area, so we take the length times the width, 3 miles, multiply it by 5280 feet per mile, and multiply it by 15 feet, and we're going to get 237,600 feet squared. For step 4, we want to convert that to square yards. So you take that 237,600 feet squared, divide by 9, and you're going to get 26,400 yards squared. Next, for step 6, we want to calculate our residual asphalt application rate. So we take that mass being applied, divide by the area applied, and we're going to get 0.30 pounds per yard squared. Are we done yet? Not yet. We're going to look at that bill of lading, and that's going to give us an 8.350 pounds per gallon. We're going to divide that, and we're going to get a final number of 0.036 gallons per yard square. That's our residual application rate, our calculation. Was that tedious? I hope not. Hopefully that'll help you guys when you're out there in the field or in the office. Some of the pros and cons. It's quick, simple, temperature correction factor is not needed, and the accuracy improves with larger areas. Some of the cons, dilution rate of vital again, so you need to know what that dilution rate is, as well as inaccurate on smaller, irregular areas. When we started these workshops around the country, we asked around. We asked some states, what are they currently using? Tables, formulas, for your inspectors out in the field. And we got this spreadsheet from Oklahoma. They use this spreadsheet for their chip seals, slurry seals, fog seals. This is how they calculate what their residual application rates are. If you're interested in this, let me know and I can provide that to you following the workshop. In here, all the calculations are done internally, so the only things you guys need to put in is the dates, some of the station numbers, the WIS, some of the gallons up front. It'll calculate what your temperature correction factor is, residual, and et cetera. All that's done for you. But this is the 21st century, right? Don't we have a smart app that can do this? Well, after our 22nd workshop, we went to Texas, and guess what? We found a guy that had an app that could create this. So not all everybody get out their smartphones and type in Asphalt Pro, but this is where you can go. Write it down, Asphalt Pro. This is where you can go to do these calculations on your smartphone. Federal Highway, we're working on trying to get an app out there for you guys, and just stay with us. Hopefully in the next 6 months we'll have something that we can share to all you guys and et cetera. Okay, we talked about volume, we talked about mass, and this is the third way of going about calibrating. And the standard is ASTM D2995. We actually use these field measurements out in the field. We take samples, we put them on the ground, we let the Tack truck go over them, and we pull them off and we get our weights. Kind of standard practice. I mean, my years in college, we used to do this for test sections on chip seals and et cetera, so it's not an uncommon practice. It's often done by a lot of DOTs. With this, you can measure your longitudinal transverse applications of materials coming down transversely or longitudinally, and then you can convert that to the gallons per square yards. As we mentioned, the method A method is taking the weigh-in pads, you pre-weigh those, you secure the pads on the surface, you apply your tack, and then reweigh the pads, and then calculate your application rate. Here's kind of an example of some pads being put down on a particular roadway in no particular order, just how the agency felt that that's what at the time wanted to do it. Then they apply the material, take those off, and get their weights. The other common method, and we were told by NCADS, probably the most practical and most best way of going about doing this is taking these little cones, this method B, volume-based calculations, putting these cones at the bottom of each one of the nozzles, and then getting your application material, your volumes. For each collector and each nozzle, you calculate a transverse uniformly, and then you go about calculating the longitudinal rate incorporated by the truck's velocity. A practice that can be done, and as I said, NCAD felt that this is probably the most predominant and most accurate method to be used. And the reason why we want to use some kind of method is because we want to try to get away from this non-uniformity issue. And we're seeing it across the country. If it's not changing their nozzles, it's making sure the equipment's calibrated, all play an important role. Some of the pros and cons with this, the pros is quick, it's simple, you don't have to worry about a temperature correction factor, and allows for randomized testing and measures across the entire spray bar. The cons, dilution rate is vital. Pretty common in each one of these. You guys need to keep that in mind. More labor intensive, potential evaporation between the emulsion, reweighing the pads. So if you don't get them off as fast as you can or as quick as you can have a little bit of difference in those weights. Any questions?